Bonjour and hi, my name is Marcus Wallant, and thanks for inviting me on such short notice. I didn't know myself until this morning. So I wanted to present you Facet Zoo, and I'm a developer, but I'm also a user, and that's the reason why Facet Zoo was created. Since, I guess everyone here has this photo collections or music collections, and sometimes, maybe a few years ago you had this somewhere in your room, a box of photos and CDs and everything, and it was just a big mess, and you wanted to organize that much better than you were able to do that today. And moving to a PC or any other computer, you would basically have the same thing. You would have a huge collection of photos and a directory structure maybe, but it was always difficult to manage. So Facet Zoo was developed. After basically two years of research at university during my graduate studies, a zoomable widget was developed that allows you to browse and filter your hierarchical metadata. Now that sounds a bit technical, so we have to go back to theory a little bit. And metadata, as some of you might know, is data about data. So data that describes other data. For example, metadata could describe your photos, what's inside it, where was the photo taken, when was it taken, and so forth. And there can be different types of metadata that are mutually independent, and these are called facets. So you have the time metadata, for example, that describes when a photo was taken, but then you could also have geographical data associated with that photo, and that would describe where the photo was taken. And those are independent, at least conceptually those are independent. So if you vary the time, it doesn't vary the location, and vice versa. So those two are examples for facets that are basically metadata dimensions that are mutually independent. And another attribute about metadata is that it can be hierarchical. So for locations, you might have a country. Inside a country, you might have states. Inside a state, you have cities or municipalities, and so forth. So it has a hierarchy associated. Same goes for temporal metadata. You start out with years, for example, which year was a photo taken, then which month was it taken, a month is a subset of a year, which day was it taken, and so on. Same goes for classifications. This is, leisure activities, and in there you would have sports or arts, those different types. So the observation was that metadata has, basically a lot of metadata has always a hierarchy associated with it. And the design that was developed for that widget is that it would show that hierarchy. So at the top you see a facet zoom widget that has been instantiated with temporal metadata. So we have years at the bottom, in the bottom row. We have a month, one row higher, and then you can see, it's a bit small here, that there's a list of weeks that constitute those years. And the next example down below is one for location, one for geographical metadata, where we have Europe, and then in there we have Germany and France, for example, and inside Germany you would have different cities, same goes for France and so on. And the third example that I gave is now here as an instance of the widget that's for different classifications. So we have leisure, arts, fairs, sports, and then we might have a different one that's, if you're a professional photographer, for example, you would have architecture or photo shootings or skyline photos and so on. And now we can use this widget to structure the data according to the hierarchy that's already visible, that was made explicit and visible. So at the bottom here, this one is a music browser example. So at the bottom, we have the different genres down here. So here is rock, and inside rock, we would have the subgenre of alternative music. And in there, we could split it further out into different types of subgenres. And then, using that hierarchy, we can draw lines upwards to structure our data. And in this case, we have musical albums that that are basically arranged according to the hierarchy that's inside the data itself already, inside the data, inside the metadata, basically. Another example that I could give you is that for temporal data, if we have stock quotes. So there are different companies here that we've listed, and that's the year 2001 that's visualized now. And as you can see in September, there was a slight drop in 2001, and you all know why that happened. So that widget can be used for different types of data. I've shown you concrete data that was music, discrete data, and this is continuous data, stock quotes, basically, that varies over time. And the demo that I wanted to give you is the widget now using time, as it was instantiated with time. So we have different years, and I can zoom, I can scroll left and right inside the widget. So, and if I feel like I want to zoom in closer to June 2002, I can just rotate my mouse wheel, and you'll see that the different hierarchies change their resolution. Because at the top level, the years are important, and the further you go in, the years become less important, because it's always the year 2002 in this case. So we can move this down, save a bit of screen space, and show those scales that are important to the user at that point. So I can zoom further in, and in this case, it stops at June 17th. And of course, on this scale, I could still scroll sideways, the other way around. And obviously, I can go back out. So I can do that with my mouse too, if I want to scroll a bit faster. And another type of navigation that is included here is that you can click on a level. So if you click on 2001, it zooms in. Click on June, week 24, and I get the days up here. Same goes for backwards. I can do it sideways, and so on. Okay. So it's a little bit buggy, as you can see, but the general idea, I think, should be clear, hopefully. And I can also drag my mouse up and down, and I'll get the same zoom effect. So I guess if you want to play with it later on, I'll be here for a while, so you can try it out. I wanted to show that here, because I think there are potential uses here, some projects that might benefit from the widget. I've seen in DigiCam there is a timeline included that you can switch between years and month. So I don't know if they would be interested to use that. And also in Blender, there's obviously a timeline for your animation that is at the foundation of the scene, basically. And you can zoom in, and it has different hierarchies too. So at the top, you might have the minutes or the hours, depending on how long your animation is. And the further you zoom in, you go down to frames. So those would be two uses that I could see. And maybe there are other uses here, other projects that I haven't seen, and that would benefit from that timeline. And it's released under the GPL license. It's written in Qt, in the Qt C++ library. So it's open source, and if you want to use it, go ahead. I'd be happy to see it in use. I'll be also happy to take any new suggestions on how it could be improved, what you would like to see. Perhaps you have other questions. So that was my brief presentation about the widget, and I'm open for questions.
What's your policy regarding the use of this widget in closed source applications?
So far, it's GPL only, and I would have to coordinate with my professor at university. I've graduated already.
Would you be willing to sell non-GPL licensing to companies that want to use this?
that could be discussed.
Okay.
I'm not saying no, but I might have to get a second opinion on that too.
Okay.
What if you get a check for $1,000?
Right now? Tempting, but don't. Yeah. It's published, so you can use whatever is there.
How is that better than just like the pop-up calendar or something?
Hmm, sorry?
How is that better than just like the pop-up calendar? You know, just like, you get like on Kayak.
How does that compare to a pop-up calendar? Is that the question?
Yeah, why is that any better? I mean, it takes up more space.
I'm still not sure.
You know, like the normal one when you go to like an airline site.
Yeah. Well, you mean the standard box calendar that you get? How does it compare to it?
I mean, how's it better?
How's it? Well, I guess an airline calendar is not used for sorting your data. It's not used for your photo collection. I guess you could use it to browse through different flights as well. You could use the FastZoom widget. So, if you have the time version, you could look what flights are available at which time of the day, and it would show you the different instances,
so
the different flights. Yeah. So it gives the user a better sense of where he's at by zooming in and out. It's very quick. In a calendar, you jump to the next page and then you jump again, and it's very abrupt and there's no animation, and it requires a lot of cognitive effort by the user.
Do you have any ideas of other types of zoomable interface? Zoomable Chrome, like what? Next question.
Like what?
If there are others, there are a bunch of different widgets like this in research, and if you look at the paper that's also online, you'll see what the different widgets are we compared it to.
Right now, your interface accesses one facet at a time.
Yes.
Have you thought of a 2D or 3D interface where you could scroll through several facets simultaneously?
Well, there's the implementation supports a vertical version at the moment, even the open source version. And obviously, you could combine two different aspects at the same, two different facets at the same time.
Just a comment on the licensing question that came up. I think you'll find that if it's been developed with the GPL version of Qt, that you don't have the option to then use it commercially.
In this case, yes, it was developed with the 4.4 version. That's GPL only. So I'm not an expert in licensing. That would be something
that
I'd have to look
at. Well,
yes.
So I've seen discussions about licensing sometimes, and I'm pretty sure that's the position. If it was going to be commercial, it would have to be developed that way.
But a commercial company using this.
A commercial company could use it,
but under GPL.
GPL license, so they're
if a commercial company were to use this, they would also have to use Qt, and they would also have to have a commercial license for Qt.
Well, I'm not sure how the transfer would be possible to take the same code that is already GPL and basically fork it and move it into non-GPL. I don't think that's possible. So that's
the business model is GPL. GPL is free, non-GPL costs money. You could simply adopt the same business model for your code.
There's
paying for LGPL.
Okay.
That.
Not to drift into the license discussion too much, I guess. There's the GPL version. There is now an LGPL version of Qt. So you could use it in a closed source application, and there is the commercial version that's still available. And the issue that I think we were talking about is the transfer, if that's possible. You could obviously rewrite the entire widget. It's 10K lines of code, not really much, and start it from scratch using the commercial library and never have to release it open source.
Is it possible to turn it upside down?
I'd have to say in theory. This implementation doesn't support it, but you could obviously
add. Like in most calendar programs or planners, it's quite common the years above and then days are lower.
Okay.
And
yeah.
And another question, you show some demos. Are there existing applications or?
Well, there were the prototype applications. Unfortunately, since I didn't know about this talk, I was giving this talk until this morning, I just grabbed the one that was on my website. That's just the plain widget. There are demos that exist. This one, for example, that uses some music collection.
It's also in the download, or it's...
No, I don't think this one is released. This is still a university project.
Since this work's been published by SickTime, presumably someone else can indeed re-implement it if they think they want to for a different widget set or whatever.
Yeah.
Correct?
Yes. Well, it's published at the CHI conference, as you correctly say, and therefore anyone could take the idea and reappropriate it.
And equally, therefore, non-compatible, since there would be prior art.
No, it's in this case, it's not patented. And I personally, I don't believe in patenting software either.
Oh, not that you would, but it stops other people doing it.
Yes, but we didn't. That's what I'm saying.
Okay, one last question? No?
Thank you very much.